play
Hardball.
I'm Bill Velasco.
I'm Boya Cizon.
Sorry,
simula,
to show with simula,
simula,
simula, simula. Usually, yung zoom out ang huli. Yung zoom in naman. Para maiba naman.
Maiba.
Galing na director ito talaga. We start tonight's first five with a story that took the sports world by shock. The Blade Runner, South African Olympic hero Oscar Pistorius, is accused of premeditated murder in the death of his model girlfriend, Riva Steenkamp. There's so much speculation as to whether this was premeditated, or if you believe Pistorius, he accidentally shot his girlfriend, whom he thought was a burglar. Okay, first
let,
of all...
Let down the premise.
He heard some noise downstairs and waddled over without his prosthetic legs, thought that the burglar was hiding behind the bathroom door, and fired four shots through the door, three of them hitting his girlfriend. And he claims to have broken down the door, although
by means
two different accounts,
yeah,
and carried her out and got help, and she died from wounds sustained from the shooting. Now the question here is if it was premeditated or accidental.
Right.
Now any gun owner knows, okay, that first you have the advantage if somebody comes into your home.
You
know
the
weapon, layout of the place.
Yeah.
If it's dark,
right,
you know where to
go. You
to
know
hide,
where to go. Yeah.
And you can just call out to whoever's invading your home that you have a firearm. Mm.
That's right. If you are a responsible gun owner or a person who knows how to handle a situation involving a firearm.
Okay, just to give you the difference, okay? If it's murder and premeditated, that's not bailable, that's life. In some countries, that's the death penalty. Okay, if it's accidental, if it's manslaughter, then that could be 6 years or less.
But this is it's his alibi for me. I will not cast judgment as of yet because
I will.
For one, you know, he has no legs, and the dynamics by which one reacts if you're not as able-bodied as we are.
Wait. That doesn't wash because he is a world-class athlete.
Okay.
Physically, he's stronger than most people.
Eh, bakit takot sa intruder?
And plus, consider the fact, if he didn't have his legs on, he was a foot shorter, and it would be easier for him to hide.
Eh, takot sa intruder.
I don't know. I don't mind.
Kaya the reactives could be different. But,
yeah, no, but my point is...
Why shoot first and ask questions
exactly,
after?
And you don't know where the other people in the house are.
Correct.
Right? I mean, you didn't even make sure that his girlfriend was in the bedroom first. You know, and make sure she's safe.
Well, another konti lang andre. Kasi I was they had dinner the night before. We don't know if they consumed alcohol.
Even if he had a
what
couple
was his
of
state
glasses
of mind?
Of wine,
was it clear? Was clear headed when he actually pulled out the gun, or was that just a knee jerk reaction to something?
And besides, why fire that many shots? Unless you really want to kill the person, okay? Obviously, you want to find out more. Meanwhile, some sad news now from the world of basketball. Los Angeles Lakers owner Jerry Buss died this week at the age of 80, losing his battle with an undisclosed form of cancer. Under him, the Lakers won 10 NBA championships from the Showtime dynasty of Magic Johnson, which won 5 championships in the 1980s, to the Kobe Bryant era we still enjoy today. Now, Jerry Buss, simply put, was the Caesar of the NBA.
Yes,
he built he even called the color purple Forum Blue. In other words,
it was the
Lakers' kingdom.
Right.
He's the one who gave Magic Johnson a lifetime contract or $1 million a year for 25 years. I mean, he thought all this stuff. He made the NBA the entertainment spectacle that it is today.
Well, Showtime will not be Showtime without the leadership and the guidance, of course, of Jerry Buss. And with this, closes out an era of great basketball, of great names that we all have seen and loved. Even if you are not a Laker fan, you know all these players that have won championships with him. And the moment you see a Laker jersey, you don't instantaneously hate it. You have a certain sense of awe with it, considering all the champions.
Well, excluding the Boston Celtics, they've retired the most number of players.
Yes.
And they were always associated with great big men and great coaching. and championships and class, you know. The only problem with being in Hollywood is that people arrive fashionably late for the games just to show that they're cool.
But still great basketball.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, moving along in mixed martial arts, women's champion Ronda Rousey is set to make her octagon debut at UFC 157 this weekend, putting her title on the line against Liz Carmouche. It's the first ever women's match of the Ultimate Fighting Championship and the first time that a women's fight will be the main event.
All right, now my question here is if it will be as appealing as the men's version, because you know, they've tried everything in other sports, like, you know, you have the lingerie football league and all these things. But the problem with the sport now is that she's just so dominating. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's no compelling rivalry. And people are going to say, if we show up late, the match is going
to
be over.
Well, I think this is exactly the point that they want to put forth. Because, well, as you've already said, she's so dominating. Dominating to the point that in her fights, she only averages around a minute and a half. Or maybe a little bit closer to about 2 minutes. But then again, that's a very impressive stat for somebody.
You'd probably last a round.
I won't even. I don't think so. Anyway, Carmouche.
Well,
Carmouche would be a good fight for her to
have. She's the one who's lasted the longest.
The longest. And number
which
two, ex-Marine. Okay, ex-Marine likes to, well, has also had a win streak for her, but lost a couple of fights. Likes to fight standing up. I think the advantage of Rousey here is she has won a lot of her fights by the armbar, and she likes it quick.
Yeah.
She's very dominant. She overwhelms you from the get-go.
Yeah.
But the secret to Carmouche is for her to get Rousey to last longer than a round and see where it takes
her. Uncharted territory.
Correct. Correct.
All right.
Correct.
Another historic event for women. This time in car racing.
Wow.
In NASCAR, Danica Patrick became the first woman to win pole position at the Daytona 500. And now, my only question is, what took you so long? No, but seriously, this is a great breakthrough for women. And, you know, it's inspiring. It sets a precedent. I'm sure the men won't be happy about it, which will make her race more exciting.
But, well, I share in your joy that sports now can be some sort of, we can call equal. There's a sense of equality now, wherein motorsports can be participated in by both men and women on the same track at the same time. Danica Patrick has been there for quite a while. There are other drivers who wanted to follow in their footsteps, but obviously the length of time that and the length of efforts that she has put into this deservingly gives her that pole spot. But looking at the lineup for Daytona, you have names like Dale Earnhardt, Tony Stewart, Jeff Gordon, Juan Pablo Montoya.
For mga ano veterans. Oh. They're all and all a little
But nobody older. Is saying that she could eventually get the win.
Well, she hasn't really been up there in terms of the rankings. But, you know, a poll is poll and it gives you an advantage going. That's the whole point of it. And let's see. Let's see what happens. And, you know, it will inspire, again, another generation of female drivers.
At the most, I think she will get into the top eight. That's as far as I would go.
I'm not even sure she can do that.
We'll see. Okay, staying in motorsports for our last topic, Phil Swiss driver Marlon Stockinger is headed for the big time. He just made the junior team of Lotus in Formula One.
And, you know, the thing about this, we do not realize. He's very excited. You know? He spoke to one of our colleagues, Dan Castillejo, earlier about it. And we don't realize how hard it is actually to be a professional race car driver because you do train like a professional athlete.
Yes, yes.
You know, we have other Filipino drivers who've made it to the international circuit. They've had a hard time. And your whole life is built around this. You know, you have your endurance, your fitness, your alertness, your response time.
There's even a PR public relations course involved now.
Exactly. And by the way, he's going to be back in the Philippines next month. For those of you who don't know, a multinational delivery company is bringing in two Formula One cars, and Marlon's going to be test driving them. And we'll, of course, break the story on Hardball as the details come.
You know what I'm?
It's great. It's great for
you know
Marlon.
What I'm actually happy about because there are a lot of really good Filipino drivers, but they haven't really just been able to crack or to break that boundary wherein one will be able to do so and the rest will start following.
Well, we've broken the stories here on Hardball, for example, that there are about five Filipino teams that are trying to raise funds to make an international NASCAR event, which was moved to April at the Charlotte Speedway. And the top two finishers in that race, they'll be racing against international drivers, will get to train with real NASCAR teams. And then, of course, we broke the story here also that Euro NASCAR is going to be held in the Philippines. It was moved to December, and it'll be held in Clark, if I'm not mistaken. All right, so, you know, a lot of stuff in motorsports.
Nice.
Up ahead, we explore possible trade scenarios in the NBA as this year's trade deadline nears. Unfortunately, no trade deadlines on Hardball. Stay with us. They're watching Hardball. It's that time of the year again. No, it's not Christmas. When NBA teams feel the pressure to make a move or two to improve their roster, make a strong playoff run, or maybe look ahead to next season. This season, the Celtics, Clippers, Nets, and Hawks are among the teams reportedly busy with their phones, not texting, but talking with other teams concerning players like the Hawks' talented forward Josh Smith, the most talked about player ahead of the trade deadline. Now, question is, for me, past couple of seasons, the Hawks have been overrated.
Mm-hmm.
It's partly his fault. It's partly the team's fault. What will they stand to gain should they trade him, and where would he go?
For me, I would say that, well, you've already mentioned that they being overrated, but they seem to lack that one or two pieces which eventually get them over the hump and into the conference final. Because ever since we started making a big deal about the Hawks, maybe that's about four years ago, if I'm not mistaken, we always said that playoff contender, playoff contender, playoff contender.
You guys.
Pero, di ba? Di ba?
Yeah.
Playoff contender. Pero biglang, at the end of the playoffs, first, second round of playoffs, bye. Wala na. So there's one
to
two
pieces.
And you
have to remember, of course, talking about Josh, he came into the Hawks very young, if you remember. You know, I met him in 2004, and you know, he was just a kid basically. So, in these kinds of situations, they're never really taught how to handle, you know, taking care of the responsibilities of running a, you know, being in charge of an NBA team. So, if they make the trade, great. If they don't, well, you know, he knows that he's not going to be there much longer. What I'm really curious about is the Kevin Garnett case.
Okay. You know, there are five teams that are on the list that apparently are interested in getting.
But, you know, for me, I think it would be very, very interesting to see him with the Clippers. You know, because, you know, remember, I've always said this, and this has been proven true in almost all NBA championship teams. You need three stars
pieces,
to carry.
Yeah, three
you need
pieces.
Three big
it's
pieces to carry a team
proven.
To the finals. So, Garnett knows he's got little time remaining. Mm-hmm. You know, he's... With a team that's about to make transition.
Right.
I don't think they're going to let go of Paul Pierce. Mm-hmm. But, you know, KG's already said he might be happier somewhere else.
But the no-trade clause of this contract was strengthened by the fact that during the All-Star break, there were reporters that asked him about it, if he wanted to get traded. He said, I'm sticking by my no-trade clause. But then again, as you mentioned, will you go out in the blaze? Would you rather retire a Celtic wherein at this point the percentage or the probabilities of you getting into the finals are very, very, very slim with the injury of Rondo? And you transfer to a team who has who will be champions in the very near future.
And you know, and not just that, the intangibles also, he's bringing leadership, he's bringing experience. He's going to make the other two guys, you know, Chris Paul and Blake Griffin, play much better.
And look really good.
And, you know, he's going to be showing off his one championship ring. And,
what should teams trade for or aspire for now? Is it the playoff push? Or already looking towards the 2013-2014 season?
Well, you know, most of the teams want to make a statement for the second half of the season. Some of them just want to win more games. Some of them want to make a push deeper into the playoffs, and we'll see what happens. Mm. My main question here is, which are those teams? Mm. Some of them, maybe they just need one backup player in one particular position, so that's not a big deal. But if you bring in another superstar player this late in the season, don't really expect that much unless you've run a lot of isolation plays for them.
So if you talk about the top four teams right now, right after the All-Star break, will they be making a move? I don't think they would be. But the lower-tiered teams, or the teams that are more or less will not be in the playoffs, mm-hmm. yun ang dapat gumagalaw eh.
Oh yeah, and the teams somewhere in the middle of the pack, because if you're in the middle of the pack, do you push to keep to raise your ranking and get a playoff berth, mm. or do you tank the season and get a high draft pick
next year,
you know, and leave some wiggle room in the salaries? No. You know, I don't know. My take on that is there won't be that much movement. There'll be probably two or three big trades, and then that's it. It's gonna be pretty quiet.
Okay, let's now go to some fan comments on our Facebook page, starting off with Rich Mabilanga. Rich Mabilanga Colita says, send Dwight Howard somewhere. I don't think it's going to happen as of yet.
I don't think it's going to happen because the Lakers are going to look stupid. Mm. You know, they're going to, first of all, Jerry Buss just died.
Right.
Secondly, they're going to look like they didn't know what they were doing, so dump him, you know.
Searching high and low, or trying to do everything to get him down, coach changes, and then
Well, Dwight was in the middle of a bad situation with all those coaching changes and the injury, of course, to Steve Nash. So, you know, it's not his fault. Of course, if he acts like a crybaby, then that's his fault.
Yeah. Okay, Romano Santos Gutierrez says Dwight to the Knicks, Chandler to the Lakers.
Why would the Knicks do that?
Why will I let go of Tyson Chandler?
Why would the Knicks do that? They're doing so well, right? In fact, they're the surprise. You know, everybody said, you're getting geriatric players all over the place, then all of a sudden they do so well.
Look at them, they're number two.
Because when you look at it, these older players, one, they have nothing to prove. Two, they really don't have any egos. You know?
The baggage that comes with being a marquee player is
not
as hard on them.
This is a last lease for them.
Right.
You know? Great for them.
Okay, Sean Anthony says Josh Smith for the Knicks, Amari Stoudemire and Iman Shumpert.
No.
Why will I go let go of Amari Stoudemire?
No. My question here is, Josh Smith has really proven himself.
Well, it's asking for the max salary already.
Well, he may deserve it as an individual talent, but you know, again, because it's partly because of him that they're overrated.
Well. That's how it is.
Let's do our hot ticket.
On last week's hot ticket, the NBA Finals rematch between Miami and OKC turned ugly early.
I told you.
The Heat raced out an early lead and held off a late Thunder comeback. Bill and Boom get the point for their right prediction.
Now, I really want to see the total tally so far.
Me too.
Okay? I really want to see. Because my record's what? 11 straight, right? So.
Oh, no. 11 straight.
So 11 we don't know. I think I must have like 7 or 8 already.
Sana wala na donuts, no?
Oh,
you'd be a fat man by now, boy.
At kape. I just lost weight, dude. Keep going.
Okay, for this week's hot ticket, it's a battle of two top teams in the NBA's Eastern Conference. The New York Knicks, currently second in the East behind the Heat, will visit the Indiana Pacers, who are third in the conference, and who wins that game.
So the question is, how well have the Pacers... by the way, the Pacers are rumored to be coming to the Philippines.
Yes, against Houston.
Against the Rockets, so that's interesting.
Nice.
Question is, how well have the Pacers been doing at home?
Well, you know, the one thing that I'm actually curious about is with this game between the number two and the number three in the East at the moment, this will set the tone for how they will be playing in the playoffs. The first game for both teams after the All-Star break, most of them were able to rest well. A lot of players were able to rest well, get their bearings back. With Denver playing at home, that's a big obviously an advantage for them, but Indiana playing at home will be a very big advantage to them. But I think New York, with how they have managed to put this season together, will stay on track and get the win?
I think it's going to be a close game, but for the Pacers, I have my doubts. So I'm going to go with the Knicks, and for once I agree with Boyet. It doesn't happen often. I'm taking a risk here.
And you made a good choice, my friend.
Well, there's no other choice. Boom's not here.
Yeah, guy.
All right. And for our last shot tonight from NBA Commissioner David Stern on the late Jerry Buss's legacy. He showed us it was about showtime, the notion that an arena can become the focal point for not just basketball, but entertainment. He made it the place to see and be seen and be late. You're the audience. And so it is.
I agree. Special thanks to Vision Express and Cubic for my eyewear, Daniel Hector for my shirts, and TW Steel. Halong kabutanan. I'm Boyet Siza.
By the way, Friday at 10 a.m. will be the launching press conference for the National Collegiate Basketball League at the TIP campus in Manila. This is going to be an alternative collegiate league, and this is just a short tournament before the actual league really opens in June. So please keep an eye on that and support an alternative league that is aiming for higher values. I'm Bill Velasco. Join us again next Wednesday when we hit hard and hit strong when we play
Hardball!
Good night, God bless. Stay safe. What do you mean? 0-2.
There's boom. There's boom. Can you see it? I tawag dyan. Confusion says. Oh, hindi naman.